All right.
Yeah, can so. Before I start, just a quick show hand. Anyone used or heard Hazelcast before? Two people, good. So for the sake of the demo, anyone ever used or heard Spring Framework before? Okay, more than Hazelcast, that will do. So today I'll try to explain you how we can scale your application using the Hazelcast in Moody Data Grid. And I will be talking with some of the features that we have, how you can use Hazelcast to scale your application. And I don't want to bore you too much with the slides. I will just test them like in 15, 20 minutes. In that time, if you have questions, please ask. You don't need to wait for the Q&A. I will be happy to answer. Then I will have a small demo, that I'll be showing minimal Hazelcast code. Actually, I don't have, other than some logging, I don't have any Hazelcast related code, but show you how you can use the Hazelcast in our data grid with your application without actually even coding anything related to Hazelcast. So let's just start it. So we're gonna look to what the remember data grid is, some common use cases where you can use it, the advantages of the Hazelcast you can bring your ecosystem, some architectures that you can use while you learn Hazelcast, the discovery and deployment options that we have currently, and some small demo and a Q&A. And the demo app is in the my GitHub repo, so you can just go and download it if you want. Just a little history. The Hazelcast memory data, the Hazelcast company itself is founded in 2008 in Turkey, Istanbul. The current day, the headquarters in Palo Alto, and we have offices in Istanbul, New York, London.
Tokyo now.
Yeah, and Tokyo now. Yeah, take a look. And Hazelcast itself is actually open source. We have an enterprise version also, but you will see the features, but most of the 85% of the features is open source. So you get Apache 2 license, so you can just go down and start using it. So just look simply what Hazelcast is. The Hazelcast is an operational in-memory data grid, but other than just the data grid, it's actually could be a distributed computing platform for you and manages your data. Allow you to execute some jobs or tasks on your data in where your data resides, not in your application, not in your let's say client application, but in the data, in the where the data itself is. So it can help you to speed up your application and also scale in the meantime. Why? So it is the important thing is actually that see that it is any memory storage. By default, you are using the Java heap to store your data. Of course, with the features that you can choose to persist your data store while storing the data in the memory. And also in our enterprise feature, the enterprise version, we have the native memory storage. So instead of storing in the native, storing in the heap, you can also store off-heap data. So instead of you can use a small heap, you don't need to worry about the GC, and you can use hundreds of gigabytes of native memory for the storage. And we have a distributed computing features. Bit is not just a caching, it actually gives you a distributed Java executor service implementation, so you can go ahead and execute jobs on the cluster itself where your data is. You can schedule some jobs, so it will be running one on another member, depends on your configuration. So just to go through, so it's actually a cluster, a data cluster, let's say. It's a distributed over multiple server. They don't actually have a number of upper limits, so you can create basically one or two node cluster, or you can try to create hundreds of thousands of Hazelcast nodes to build a cluster. It's actually the same in terms of Hazelcast from Hazelcast perspective. It is in the enterprise version, everything is stored in the it's basically everything stored in the RAM, but you know, mostly in the Java heap. But if you are using the enterprise version, it is actually stored in the actual RAM, so off heap. So you can shrink or increase the number of members of the cluster anytime you want. So you don't need to change anything on your current cluster. So you just create, or just if you want, you can just write one line of code, start a member, or you can just download the binary and just start it. That's it. That's easy. And it's actually an object model, so it's not a relational database, but we have some features that actually that you can use, like querying of the data that is resides in the memory. The Hazelcast itself is written in Java, so the Hazelcast nodes storing the members are actually Java applications, but from the client's perspective, so you can actually connect to this cluster using different clients. So currently we have Java, C++, C#, Node.js, Python, and Go clients. So you can use any of those clients and connect to your cluster and do some operations on your data. Get store data, execute some operations, etc. And it is actually resilient to data losses. So by default, it stores some backup of your data. So even though you lose some of your nodes, so you won't be losing any data. It actually depends on your configuration, because by default we store a backup, but you may choose not to store a backup or store more than one backup in multiple nodes. So it is up to your configuration. Actually, it's up to you. So it gives you the storage, computing, and messaging options, and all of them is actually in memory. So it brings the speed of in-memory storage and in-memory computing to you. So why actually do you need it? So it actually depends on it comes to the topic of the talk. So maybe you have an application that is using a legacy database, or actually a database, and there's the bottleneck for you because you want to scale, and your database is your single point of your data. So when you scale, again, all your nodes need to connect to the database, but since you're connecting from multiple nodes, multiple application instances, so it may be slowing down, or your data size increases, and this can also lead the database to slow down. Or maybe you just want to cache some data. You have your databases, yes, but you want to access some data faster than you're accessing to the database. For some modern application, you may actually choose, say that, I have this database, I'm storing all my data there, but I want to use an object data store for in the memory database, so that I will use it as my primary data store, and I will maybe come from time to time, or instantaneously backup my data to somewhere else. This somewhere else is possibly up to you. It could be a database, it could be our relational database, an object database, whatever you want, actually. Or you need to access data with no SQL capabilities. You want to access as an object, but also you want to access your data with some, let's say, a querying capability. So, okay, it is accessing the data with the key value. Okay, but you need to be able to, query your data with maybe some predicates. This could be another use case. Or you said that, okay, I have the data, but I need to do some operations on this data, but I don't want to, bring the data to my application instance all the time, because maybe your data is huge, process the data. Each time you need to transfer all your data from your storage to your application instance, maybe it is hundreds of megabytes of data, maybe, you know, gigabytes, so you don't need to move this data back and forth with your application and your data store. So it could also be an option to choose an in-memory data. So it will give you the advantage of, as I mentioned before, it will store all your data in the memory, so you don't need to read from slow disk. Depends on the architecture that you're using or the instance, you know, number of instances that you are running. So it can actually scale to from a couple of gigabytes to terabytes of data. It is actually up to your configuration, to be honest. By default, in our case, actually most of your data is that even they distribute your data between the room, so you don't need to actually consider too much about the data distribution. It is fault tolerant, so you knew that even though you lost either one or some of the members, so your data will still be there, so it will be accessible, so it will prove to in some level prove to the failures. So you can access your data, as I said, with the key value, not as key value, or actually with the queries, so this is also good. And also, maybe it's, you know, in some cases, depends on your actually data, but it will allow you to update your data in big chunks, because in some cases, maybe your data is actually too big, and you are trying to update some part of your data. So it is imperative that you don't bring all this data to back and forth to just update one single property of the data. So it is an important capability. So some simple use cases, we will actually look some of those use cases in the demo application. So let's see this, as mentioned, this high density caching. So the Hazelcast actually is the full JCache support. We will actually look in that one, also in the demo. So it's an in-memory database. As I said, it gives you distributed computing, distributed clustering, and it's scalable. If you want, in some different ways, you can integrate your data store. We have some internal ways that you can integrate, or we have some some integrations with some frameworks like Spring that you can actually use their tools to integrate with your database using the Hazelcast. So if you have a microservice application or if you have a monolithic application and you want to move it to a microservice architecture, you can also you may need things like network discovery, or if you are in a container, Kubernetes, or maybe in AWS, you may need some intelligent discovery. So also, as I said, we have integrations with Spring Cloud and Spring Boot. You can use the Hazelcast, since it's a Java library and Java application, you can actually use it inside your application. So it could be a part of your application, or you can have a separate data grid somewhere, store your data, and you can tell your application to be a client, just to connect to the data store, insert data, update data, send some operations to be to be executed on the cluster itself. We have web session clustering feature, which we'll be also looking in the demo application. So by default, we have libraries for Tomcat and Jetkin, and actually for a generic one that you can use for any other web server to cluster your web sessions. Also, we have integration with, Spring Session, so you can actually use it, just seamlessly integrate with any web server that is that Spring has been using. So just some features. So as I said, Hazelcast itself is open source. So here all the features that is called the provision support. It actually is open source. So everything here in orange, so you can just download and start using it. It's free. As you see, we have some client languages. We have actually some protocols. The Hazelcast itself is implement JavaNative concurrent map. So if in your application you have a Java map, so you can basically just replace it with the Hazelcast. IMAP, we call it, is a distributed map. So your application will continue to work as it is, but it will be using a distributed map instead of a local map. So it's just a simple replacement. We have implementations for a Hibernate second level cache, so you can just integrate the Hibernate, you'll also see that one, and use the data grid as a Hibernate cache. Also, this is a common use case that we are seeing. We have this Jellycache implementation. Also, we have support for, other than, since it's a map, you can access, use the Jellycache map interfaces, get and put and etc. But also, you can use the strong query-like features that we have, so you can, run some predicate queries on the data that you have. You may create some indexes to speed up the, this query thing. So we have intelligent operations like entry processors, so that instead of doing an operation on the data here, or getting the data, updating it or doing something with the data, and then updating the data, again, you can actually send the operation itself to the cluster, so it will be processed much, much more faster. Our clustering is actually part of the Hazelcast API, so you don't need anything. Any other tool or library or something else to create a Hazelcast cluster. Then we have a single jar file, and then you are using that jar file. It is with that jar file that you are actually creating the cluster itself. So then you create a single member, and then you create a second member. They will automatically, if you configure them correctly, of course, they will automatically find each other and build the cluster. It is the protocol that we implemented. We have some automated cluster discovery mechanism, as you see that in AWS for Azure, consume Eureka. So if you're using those ones in your application, you can also use those tools or frameworks or environments so that your cluster members are found by using those libraries or SPIs, if you want, actually. By default, we are using the network-based discovery. So as I said, it is by default the only storage. So everything is in memory in Java.
So if you're you running a cluster in a more native way in like Azure, will your Hazelcast XML configuration look different then?
We have a Azure SPI, Discovery SPI. So basically what it is that if you have a node that automatically the Azure can stop your nodes, so you don't know anything about the IPs and etc. of the node, so they can start and stop, depends on your load. So you can configure the Azure Discovery plugin, giving the necessary parameters. So Hazelcast member actually will go and ask the related Azure service and get the IPs of the nodes that you are currently running from that service. So when you scale up and you have more members, when a new member come and join, it go and ask this information. It will just go maybe 10 different IP addresses, and it will try to connect to all of them, because it will see that each of those instances might be an application, an instance that the Hazelcast could be running. You can, of course, with some properties, you can just set them, not all of them, but maybe some specific instances only contain SQS. For example, in AWS, with using some tags, you can just say that, okay, only the instances that I have with this specific tag and the value are the instances that I've been running in Hazel. And you are giving either, for example, for the AWS, like your you know, secure key, an application key, or if you have a, what is it, if you have this AWS ID, you know, the user that you're using, you can actually use that one also just to discover the instances that you have. So normally when you are deploying a data center, you know all the IP addresses that you are running your application. But in the cloud, you don't know. Maybe you are scaling now. So these ones actually help the Hazelcast discovery while the instances start to find out what are the other, where are the other instances of the Hazelcast in this environment. So how can I find them? So, okay, so we have by default, as I said, this on-heap storage, but these you know, darker blue ones and these lighter blue ones, let's say, these are some enterprise features. The darker blue ones are related to the native memory. So it is actually, if you have an enterprise license, you can, instead of Java heap or in some cases, you know, both Java heap, also you can store your data in off heap. So instead of, you know, using just the, you know, storing a couple of gigabytes of data, you can just have a small Java heap to not be affected by the GC, and you can define a hundreds of gigabytes of a native heap. So all your data will be stored in there, but only some operations while the data is updated there and be, you know, and be requested by any member or a client while it's being written back to the socket, so it will be just available on the heap for a short amount of time, and that's it. We have this hub, this dot store, which is actually store your data in a disk space file, so when you shut down and start up the whole cluster again, you will be, you know, you will get your data faster off instead of, you know, reading it from a database or somewhere else. And it is working in basically in most of the JVMs that we're testing. It's Azure, the OpenJDK, Oracle JDK, JDK versions 6, 7, and 8. For the 9, since the some features that we are using in the HD memory, it is, you know, as you know, the JDK 9 is, you know, deprecated some of the APIs and etc. So we are now testing with the compatibility with the JDK 9 and also with the 10, since, you know, it's just there. So we don't run ten of credits most probably. So if we can run 10 of this JDK on any of the operating system, so you can basically use Hazelcast. And you, for the deployment, actually, you will see, you know, another nice slide, but, you know, for the deployment, you can either deploy it to your, you know, a data center, or you can choose any, you know, cluster like AWS or Azure or Docker, or you can, you know, install to VM or whatever you want. So these, as I said, rather than these dark blue, everything that I talk about, everything that you see here, is open source. So you can just download and, you know, start using it. We have a pretty good team that is being looking for the open source issues. So we have a GitHub channel, so you can just, you know, type your questions there, or you can, you know, create an issue in the Stack Overflow or a GitHub repo, so, you know, it will be answered shortly. But for the enterprise customers, or for ones that, you know, for the pay for the enterprise, we have some other features like, you know, security suite, land application, so you may have two different or maybe multiple sites and you want to replicate your data within those sites, so it is for those kind of operations. A rolling upgrade feature, so when we are releasing a new version of the Hazelcast, actually you don't need to shut down all your cluster and start again, so you can start, so you can actually upgrade your members one by one, and then it will, then your cluster will be updated after your bus member is being started. And we have some enterprise deployment environments like Pivotal Cloud Foundry and Red Hat OpenShift content platform. So if you have, if you are using those platforms, and you can check and see the Hazelcast offerings there to use and deploy those environments. So any questions so far or anything that you want to ask? So before we go to the demo, I just want to talk about a little bit of the deployment strategies that we have. So basically, since it is a Java library on Google application, so we have two different kinds of deployments, as you know. You can actually track Hazelcast as part of your application, which is, in this case, each of your application instances is part of the cluster, a holding some part of the data, so we call it is the embedded mode. So in this mode, this is only available for Java because the Hazelcast server or Hazelcast node are actually Java applications. So it is a Java library, so it is only available for Java. Or you can have a Hazelcast cluster somewhere in your data center, and your applications might be some clients that could be Java or .NET or C# or Node.js or anyone that we are currently implemented. So you can use any of those applications at the same time to connect that cluster to to do some operations. It doesn't like that you need to have a single cluster, so it needs to be only to be accessible to Java. No. We have an open client protocol, so basically it is also open source, so you can download and use it to create a Hazelcast client in any language. So it will just give you some template, then by implementing some APIs, you will have a working Hazelcast client in any language that you want to implement. So generally, the embedded mode that is actually used for rapid prototyping, and if you are using microservices and with a small number of instances, so it could be good for you, or maybe you have an application, and if you wanna you wanna integrate the Hazelcast to your application as an OEM, so you might wanna choose the embedded mode, because in this case it will be part of your applications. You're going to be deploying your applications with the Hazelcast instance itself. So if there are multiple nodes of the applications running in an environment, so it will just build a cluster. In this case, you will build a data cluster, but you can also treat that as an application cluster, depends on your use cases, to be honest. So it's easy to use. You can just start it as it is. It is it is so easy. Just one line of code I will show you. But the thing is actually here. So if you have an X number of nodes, so which means that only one divided by X of that data will be in any of the local members. So which means also that if you have 10 members, only 10% of the data will reside in the single number. So when you have a bigger cluster, you will lose the benefit of embedding more, because the data will be spread out. But in the client server mode, actually, it is good for scaling out or scaling up deployment, because maybe your data storage is enough, but you have different, you have more, you need more application instances. So you can deploy as much instances as you want. It is your application. Since your data store is there, or data grid is there, it won't be affected by your application architecture changes. It will be just maybe a couple of more clients connected to the cluster itself. So by using this mode, actually, it's traditional client server mode. For the scalability perspective, it is also much more better, because you can control your application and your cluster different. One side is your application cluster, the other side is your data cluster. So it's up to you to scale which one in, you know, how many ways that you want. Also, while using this mode, since you're using the client, with the enterprise of Linux, you can also add some security options, so you can prevent some of your clients to access some of the data or some of the APIs of the cluster, actually. So it could be IP-based, it could be operation-based, actually. It is up to you. So this is just a wrap-up for the discovery and the deployment options that we have. As I said, you know, you can use any of those. And, we have mostly for all of them, not just yourself, but you know, for the JCloud, for Amazon Web Services, for Kubernetes, we have for console, we have this the discovery SPIs that we have. It's open source, and if you go to GitHub Hazelcast, you will see most of them there. So just, you know, download and use them. There's all of them have some, you know, readmes and how to integrate it with the Hazelcast cluster. It's actually the same. Only thing that you need to have this, you know, this specific jar file and some configuration with the Hazelcast. And that's it. So, I will go to the demo, but before that I can actually, you know, get your questions, if you have any.
Yeah? In the embedded mode, if you want to launch a new instance, can you disable the in-memory data grid on that instance and just let the application scale, not the memory?
Yes. Well, actually, it's, you have two options. The Hazelcast have one client mode, which means that this node doesn't hold any data. It is just a client, it just connects to the cluster itself.
Okay.
Or maybe you want that node to be part of the cluster itself, but you don't that node to hold any data. So we have that option also, we call it light member. It is a member of the cluster itself, but it doesn't hold anything. It is just part of the cluster, but anytime you need it. So you can tell that member, okay, I need you to be part of the cluster now. So promote to be a member. So now, then it became a real member, and the other members share some of the data with that member also. So it still became a, you know, full-fledged member. So just going to the application. So, okay, the application is actually, you know, nothing fancy. Anyone can see it? I think it's a little small. Small. Okay, just make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so it's actually a basic Spring application if you're using the Spring framework. The only thing here is to see is just two things. I basically enabled caching here, and I have this the Hazelcast sessions enabled. What it does is actually, let's go see some configuration file and see what it does. So in the application, other than some logging purposes here for some, you know, listeners to log some entries when, you know, when the cache is populated, I don't have anything Hazelcast related. I only have these two you know, files. So this one is actually is a member configuration file. Let me make it a little bigger. So we have an application called Management Center that you can actually see your members, see the data, how much data. And we said that I'm showing you just the configuration. Here is actually the network. The configuration, but in this example, I am just saying that hey, all of my members are in my localhost, so only look for the localhost. I know normally you will be, since this is a TCP/IP discovery, so you can either put, you know, the IP address of all members here, or you can use the discovery options and you can say that hey, okay, I am using AWS, here is my AWS credentials, please look. These IPs, you know, these configurations to find my instances. So, also here is a nice feature that have been added in 3.1 9 version, which is currently the latest version, but 3.10 will be released in a couple of weeks, I suppose.
Yep.
So this is a user code deployment feature. What it is actually, if you have, you know, if your applications have some classes that your cluster needed to process some data, it could be a runnable, it could be an executable, whatever it is, you can actually send this class itself to the cluster. So this basically loads your data, your classes from the client side or any member to the cluster itself. So it will be available there. So even though this member doesn't have these classes in their cluster, the clients will know while they are executing the code. So it is, you know, you need to, of course, you need to enable it. It's an opt-in feature. So as I said, we have actually two modes. One is this is the map. This is the one that implements Java util concurrent map. So you can define some, you know, features. I just configure here the listener just to log out, just to print some log lines here. And here also we have the Jcache implementation of Hazelcast. So while using the Jcache, it is also just a listener, just to print some log files. Just quickly go through. Okay, so how are we gonna create a Hazelcast cluster? Is actually this line of code here. So I have this one line of code here, Hazelcast instance. So we have another one, it is Hazelcast client dot, you know, need Hazelcast client. Basically, this one create a Hazelcast instance, the other ones create a Hazelcast client. That's it. So if you have this configuration file in your cluster that I showed you, it will automatically pick up that one. Or if you want, this one is also get a programmatic configuration for you, so you can just configure it in your application and, you know, start it. So let's just start it. Let's see. So what am I gonna do first? Let's see. I'm not gonna. Okay, so I have, let's configure this one. So I'm actually telling the Spring that, you know, use the Hazelcast as a caching framework. So I also configured my Hibernate second level cache so that it also uses the Hazelcast. And I am telling that, okay, this is my client instance. So my application here will be a client. So I will create some Hazelcast instances with the code that I showed you, just a 1 minute code. So they will view the cluster itself. So you're gonna see the cluster also. And my application is gonna be a client, and it will just connect the cluster. So in this case, I will be using the caching options that Spring gives me, which Hazelcast implement. So I will be using the Hibernate caching. And I will also be using the Spring caching, so Spring session caching, using the Hazelcast, which is actually this annotation. So I don't need to put anything else for that one. But again, even if you are not using Spring, we have, as I said, we have session caching enabled for Tomcat and Jetty specifically. So we have plugins. Again, open source for a different version of the Jetty content, you can just download and use it. Then also we have a generic one, filter based, so it will just, you know, you can use in any application server so that, you know, you can replicate the sessions between the different nodes of the application service. So I will be running this one, as you see, so it's gonna start a Hazelcast member, and since there is no other member, as you see, it will be just running. Actually, yeah, it's not showing. It is just a single line of. Okay, here it is. So it's a single member cluster now. But if I run another instance of this application, it is just as you know, this same thing, that one line. So it is now trying to find the node. So voila, it has just found that there's another instance with the same configuration that I've been in the same network and the same IP addresses. This is, since I only configured the local host, so it just created a two-node cluster. This is this the management center that I've been showing you. Telling me, sorry, so let me see. Okay. 4. So it is again a Java application. It is a WAR file actually. So you can, it's an executable WAR file. You can just start it as it is, or you can deploy to any web server, the application server to start up. It is not open source, but if you have a cluster small enough, like 2 nodes or less, so you can actually use it. You can just download it. If you have more members, then you need a license to use. That's why I can see my nodes here. I can click off them, see some stuff. I can run GC, I can shut down the member, whatever I want. So I can see all the instances that I have. So all the distributed objects that I have. It could be map, cache, or whatever I have. So I'm going to be running my application now to see that it is connecting to the cluster itself. Again, I don't have any hazy-related code inside the application. It is just a it's just a simple Spring application. I just used the configuration. So here it is. It just found that a cluster with the two node, and this is my client. Client member. Listener. So this acts as a client, connect to the cluster, and when I look to the management center, I actually see it, that there is this client application connected to you. I can currently only Java clients is available here, but you can also see the others. So when you need it, let's see that I have a couple of endpoints that I can actually show you. So it has a random port. Let's see what is the port number. Okay. This is the port number. So I have this local host. So I have this endpoint. This one is actually calculate the Fibonacci number and just print the number itself and the time that passes. So I need the security here. Pass through that. So it is not my, because it is not Fib actually. Controller, yeah, it is REST. So it is REST Fib 20. So it just calculated with Fibonacci 20, and it just passes like 123 milliseconds. If I try to calculate, so you see that it is actually 48 milliseconds, but the reason for that is actually this. So I have a simple map here that you can see. I have a 41 cached value here, which actually, whenever this method or my endpoint is just hit it, it just creates a cached endpoint. So if I run it again, it will just hit the cached endpoint. So even if I go and run another application instance, I'm just running the same instance, the same application, but a second time, it will just create another instance, so it has a different port. Let's go and see. So in this case, it is also, as you see, it is also fast, because this one is also, as you see, connected to my cluster. So I have a cluster somewhere, a data cluster, and I am I need more application instances, and now I'm creating a multiple instances of the same application again, and I am, you know, it is actually going and hitting the same, the controller on that application, but the data or the cache itself is somewhere shared in the HazyNet cluster, so I don't need to calculate those values again. So this is actually data caching. So this is, you know, one of those bugs there. So all I needed to do in this case is that this is my controller. It is just calling this service. There is this simple annotation. It just caches. And this one, as you see, the name of this one, the field, is actually the name of my map. So it just caches there. So this is what Spring actually gives us. But in the underlying, you know, it's a HazyCast cluster, it's a HazyCast client that seems to come in. So then you need to use it without Spring, or it could be a Java EE, you know, J2EE, or it could be like a standalone application. You have options like, since this map is an implementation of Java util map, so you can basically treat it as a simple map and replace your map implementation that you are storing some, you know, lookup values or some data, and just replace it with the HazyCast equivalent, and you know, you can continue to use it. So you don't need to change anything in your application code mostly, other than the initialization document. So instead of using a new hash map, you just need to do the HazyCast instance.cast map. That's it. It will return you a map instance. Your application doesn't need to know anything. It will be just a map, but you will be using a distributed map. So one simple, so we are seeing some other, actually, we are seeing some other maps here. So this one, as you can understand from the name, is actually a session map. Let's see my session map also. So I have a secure controller here. Let's see, it is, the name is, let's see, secure, and so this is my session ID. It's 9 something, and F5. So this is one of the instances. If I go to the other instance, and the port number was this one, open this first, so we can see that one. So I'm opening the other instance now. So as you see, these are two different applications, but they're actually sharing the same session, because the session information itself is stored in the HazyCast. So if it's your web application and you need to share the same session between your application instances, so this is how it is. It's just, as I said, in this case, it's just one line of code. Or if you're using vanilla Tomcat or Jetty or any web or application server, you just need to add a couple of configuration to your web XML file, and that's it. You don't need to change anything in your application, but it will be just changing how the session is stored, and that's it. And one other thing that I will quickly show you is this endpoint. Let me show you. So this is there are some entries that I already have in my MySQL database. This is the Hibernate that's bringing those entries. So I am showing the SQL statement that Hibernate is actually running. But then I look to the logs here, so I'm not seeing anything. So if I, for example, here, the last ID is 10. So if I try to ask for the 11, it will just create one for me, because I have some dummy code there. It's just create. So if I look here, I see that, this node is go and create some data in the case of Hibernate or the MySQL using Hibernate, so I can see it. But the next time when I hit either this or actually this. So I'm not seeing anything because again, it is in the cache. So even though this is a, you know, this is your data in the database that you are querying the hibernate, either with the ID or a simple query. In this case, I'm actually using what this one uses the ID-based query. The other one was just you getting everything from the database. So it is actually, let me show you, it is actually stored here. If I open this, you will see that this is the name of my project that I've been storing it. So if I click here, map browser, and if I enter the key, it will actually turn me, let's see, I think it will change. Which one is this? Ah, it's a, you know, the spare ID is different, sorry. So this one is for the Fibonacci numbers, for example. If I click any of them and try to see, so I am seeing the actual values that I've been actually storing here. If it's an object, not a simple, you know, value like here and long, and if you have a print, you know, toSelect method, it will just, you know, print you something here that you want to use. So you can actually see how your data is distributed between numbers. So this is the end entries. This is the backup entries by default. It is, but yeah.
So what's the maximum users that have access to the same file?
Which file?
So the local host is the same file for both tabs, right?
It's not at the file, this is the application instance. So it is the, you know, the Spring Boot application that I'm running here, this one. Or this one, if you are saying this, this is the management center. You can define as many users as you want. Which one are you asking? This one? Or this?
The other two tabs, there are
So, okay, I mean, you know, there is no limit actually. It is just a web application. You can define as many users as you want. Or you can just, if it is not enough in your use case, for example, you have many users and you need to scale, you just can create another one. And it will again, in the same tree, connect the cluster, will share the data, share the session, in this case, share the Hibernate second level cache and etc. So it, if the data is already in the cache, which in this case it is, so the new instance will be just reading from the cache itself. It won't be, you know, hitting any like underlying database or, you know, creating a new session for the use cases, which are talking users and etc. So here in this example, I try not to use anything specific. I mean, no HTTPS related code. The only code that I use actually here is for logging purposes, which actually we can see here. So when I created a map entry in my Fibonacci endpoint, it just prints the entries. So this one, these are my two nodes. So this one is, say, the 35. And 38 edit. And when I look to the other one, I will see the other. So this will have 31 and 39, and the other one is actually have this, you know, 32, 33, whatever. So distribution is actually based on the partitioning that has been done internally. So there's a, you know, hash code implementation. It just calculates a random partition number and it distributes your data.
Yep. Is there a good write-up somewhere you can refer us to about how Hazelcast repartitions the data when nodes are added or removed?
Yeah. Let's see if I can go to hazelcast.org.documentation. And the latest documentation, you can actually find everything that you have. Here actually, you can find everything here regarding how the data is partitioned, how the, you know, the data is repartitioning, anything. The, basically what happens when a new node joins, the partitions stored by default, we have 271 partition, but you can increase or decrease the number if you want as a property. Each number holds some partitions. When a new node joins, the current node shares some of the partition with the new node. So those partitions are migrated from current node to the new node. So after this operation completed, the cluster itself balanced. So after that point on, so you can continue to use the cluster safely. You can use the cluster before in between while the data is replicated, but the partitions that is being moving between the members won't be accessible through those time because the data is now on the fly. It's not owned by any member. It is owned by this member, but it is moving the data to other partitions. So read operations are okay, but write operations are blocked while the partitions are migrated because it will break the consistency of the data.
Can you write your custom partitioning or sharding logic?
Yeah, actually we have partition grouping. Let's see. Partition group configuration. So by default, our partitions are member based, which means that each member holds some partition. You can say that, okay, I am running multiple instances on same physical server, and I want my partition groups not member-based, but IP-based. Which means you are saying that if I have four instances on the same server, none of these four instances can hold backup of any of the nodes that is holding the primary data in this group. So if the node one or the partition one is in this physical server, the backup of this partition one needs to be stored in some other physical server. Or if you are using AWS, for example, you can configure JCloud or Azure, you can say that I want my partitions based on some group name or rec name or host name. So you can also configure that. Or you can simply say that I want to create a custom one, so I want to give the IP addresses, so distribute the partitions between those members evenly. So you can choose those partitions scheme. Or you have an SPI, you can write whatever, how you want to distribute the partitions between the member you want. It is in its cloud.
Yep. So you mentioned consistency, so obviously it takes care of the asset property, the multiple client access and similar.
Yep. So the thing is there, when you are accessing the data, reading it's okay. When you are writing the data, the hazel cast is the current versions, the threading or the partition. We have something called partition thread. So everything that's being written or need to be read from the partition need to be read by a specific thread. So other than those threads, no one can read or write data. So each thread in this pool are responsible for one or multiple partitions. Depends on your node. If you have just, let's say, two nodes, which means that each node will have like 125 partitions by default. If you have a 10 core machines, by default you will have a 10 partition thread. So each thread will be responsible for 13 to 14 partitions. So that single thread is responsible to read and write to that 13th thread. If it's writing to one partition, the other operation that needs to be write or read to that partition needs to wait until this operation is completed. So it's pretty safe. Of course, there are operations and options that you can offload some operations, like read operation, so the partition threads are not blocked. But these are some features that you can use while using the HazelCast. In that case, you need to write some you need to use HazelCast interfaces to write some HazelCast specific code to achieve that. Any questions regarding the clustering or partitioning or the demo application itself?
I've got a question. So yeah. just out of curiosity, what sort of use cases do you see out there? Do you see more sort of homogeneous applications where there's multiple instances of the applications that are sharing the cache? Or do you see heterogeneous sort of architectures where you have different applications.
Well, well, actually, that depends on the company that is using. In some cases, we see that if it's a Java shop, they mostly first they wanna use it as a cache, but also they want to use it as a. In some cases, they wanna use it as their primary data source. So, in this case, I use simple Hibernate based integration. But Hazel case itself has a interface with you call map store or map loader. So you can actually write some logic using that to load and store data from wherever you want. It could be a database, it could be a service, whatever you want. It will be in cache. While writing data, loading is something, while writing the data, we have options to write delayed. So you can say that I want everything to be persisted first to my data store, and then updating the cache. Or you can say, I need to use Hazel cache, just update it, and in 10 seconds later, go collect all those updating updates and send it to this implementation so it will be updated in your data store. Or in some cases, I just mentioned that, but we have a distributed executor capability. So people want to run some jobs in their clusters periodically, so they can use Hazel cache for that. That purpose also, we have distributed Java util executor service and distributed Java util scheduled executor service. So you can schedule a job in the cluster itself. So it will be running in one of those members. You will send the job from here, but the job itself will be running on those members. So this is where this actually the class loading feature comes to use. Either you're going to deploy the all necessary runnables and etc. to the cluster, or you're just going to send it. That's it. Any other questions or anything you want me to explain in detail or anything that you want to mention?
Are there any use cases that you wouldn't use Hazel cache?
Well, if you are...
Less than three clusters.
Sorry?
If there are less than three clusters, a lot of people want to try to do one for like the cluster.
Or if you want to, if you want to process like a streaming data, because in some cases the people want to use Hazel cache as a streaming process. Since we have a distributed executor, they think that they can use it as a kind of stream processing engine. But actually, it is not. You can use those executables to process some attributed data for some periodic task, etc. But if you are processing stream, then we have a sister product called Hazel cache Jet. It's basically like a Spark or Flink. So it is for processing stream, real stream data. So if it's that kind of a use case, then Hazel cache itself is not suitable, but the Jet is using Hazel cache underlying for this building clusters for the data, but has a different concept of distributed job processing. So this is a totally different area. So Hazel cache use cases are mostly distributed caching, distributed task execution, not stream processing, distributed task execution, data offloading, because some people want to, they have huge data somewhere and they can't, read or they can't, access that data fast enough. So they offload some of them to the Hazel cache with some TTLs. You can, define some time to leave on your data. So the data will be refreshed based on your use cases and etc. It will just go read some new data, expire the old one, etc. Or in this case, you want to replicate your web sessions, you want to replicate your Hibernate second level cache. Overall use cases, to be honest, most of our users are basically, correctly, if I'm wrong, using the Hazel cache as a caching and some task execution feature. But other than caching, actually, I didn't mention, there are lots of features, but we have some specific features that is being used for fast updating data. Because in this case, if I'm inserting and updating a single long, it's just a long. But imagine that you have a model that actually, let's say, 1 megabyte. So when you want to update a single property in that object, so you can't just get the data back from cluster, update one single property and send it back. So we have operations for that to send the operation itself to the cluster with just one property, so it will be just updating the data in the cluster. So it will be much, much, much more faster while updating. So I will be shutting down this one. So if you have questions that I will be happy to answer. So there are some useful links that I want to show you. So our open source website is hazelcast.org. You can download our hazelcast there. You can look at the documentation that I showed you a couple of minutes ago. You can create some issues with Stack Overflow or ask some questions. Stack Overflow, Google Group, we have a Gitter actually, so you can just type your question there. One of our team members, myself, one of my engineers, will be answering. And there are really good code samples in our GitHub repo for different use cases. So if you can just go and see what kind of use cases or what kind of features that Hazelcast have and how you can use them. And you can just, if you want to look to the source code, it is there in GitHub. You can just, fork it or just get it and see what's, how Hazelcast doing the partition. And if you want to deep dive and see how the things are in the logo.
One more.
Yeah?
So if there is a cache naming collision, like you're using Fib for storing your Fibonacci results, right?
Yeah.
If there is some other function that also uses the same thing,
okay.
Would Hazelcast automatically handle it, or is it on the user to rectify it?
It is the user. Because Hazelcast is not actually creating any of those objects. So it is user. When you are first time access to a cache or distributed map, whatever, if it is not already in the cluster, it is in creating. So it is up to you if you want to use the same map to store multiple different instances of data, because the Hazelcast maps are not typeset. So you can actually put anything you want. One key could be an object, one key would be an integer. It is up to you how you want to put and get your data. Yes?
So one of your slides earlier
mentioned
the real-time updation scenarios.
Yeah.
What kind of a case would be a real-time updation scenario?
Let me see.
Before this.
Real-time data integration. So if you have a, let's say, if you have multiple data points that you are getting to your data, so getting to your cluster, you maybe have like a Kafka source, you will have a database, you will have a REST service and etc. So you will have both combine them. Using Hazelcast's internal features, you can write some tasks to run while you are inserting the data, so integrate them in a way and update your cluster, update your data maps or data caches. Yep. And also while using the JET, as I said, you can do this in real time. With the Hazelcast, it will be near real time, but with the JET, it will be actually real time processing of the data.
Yes, and JET's open source. JET is
it's also open source.
It's also open source. It's based on DAG architecture. So if you're familiar with how that kind of streaming process happens, it's actually kind of a really new thing. We didn't get into it too much here tonight, but I encourage you to go take a look at that code as well and see what you're doing. So a lot of IoT type of deployments that's very useful. A large marketing company uses it right now to process their data. In, like you say, near real time, but in a stream flow, and then output it into various other areas.
So in here that I didn't show you, but actually if I introduce this as a variable, this, then I want to create an app to answer your question. So this is actually like, you know, say, test. So it will be just returning an IMAP, which is actually a, I can click the control here, which is actually extends the Java to compute. So it is actually a compute map or an app. So your application from this point of view, it won't know anything about if it is dealing with the Hazelcast itself or it is a local map or whatever. You can just simply replace this with the Hazelcast map and it will be working fine. Yep.
Let's say you have a team of experienced JVM developers,
okay,
and they have a scaling problem that is going to involve caching. The team is familiar with Redis. What would be sort of a good set of technical arguments to have that team looking at Hazelcast instead?
First of all, no, the Redis is by design. It's not, it is, correct me if I'm wrong, it is single threaded. So it is internally just single thread application to prevent some, you know, issues that you can have using the, you know, the multi-threading. So in this case, so it is not actually using the full scale of your underlying system. So in order to use it, you need to create multiple instances of Redis's on the same server so that you can utilize your CPU more and more. In the Hazelcast case, you can, you know, our thread pools are configurable, all of them. So you can either leave it like this and use, you know, let Hazelcast use it, or if you are sure that your application server or, you know, server is enough to handle the load, you can increase the thread pools, you can configure them with your use case. Because some of them for, like, you know, querying, if you're not gonna use them, you can just shrink them and update, you know, they increase the partition, then, you know, the threads and etc. Also, the Hazelcast application, you know, the library itself or the memory itself is written in Java. So if you are using, you know, if you have the JVM, the developers that is experienced in JVM, which is Java, so you can actually leverage that knowledge with the Hazelcast itself. So they can directly use the Java API. They can go deep into the core of the Hazelcast, which is, you know, there, open source, and see what is going on behind. And most of these, as with the partitioning schema, is actually pluggable. So you can just write some of your, you know, write some implementations. For the discovery, you can write your own discovery. A couple of weeks ago, I just write a simple REST-based discovery. So it is easy. You need to implement just one or two classes. That's, so you can write a new partition grouping. You can write, you know, some other internal features. So you can actually configure Hazelcast the way that you want to use. So it is actually not possible in Redis. So you need to use whatever you have in Redis.
When you're running it in embedded mode,
yeah,
can you actually partition the resources between Java application and Hazelcast?
When you mean partition the resources?
Like, if there's like a huge write that's coming in into Hazelcast,
okay,
is it going to choke the Java application running on the same machine?
It depends. If it's right, if it's coming to that node, and that node cannot handle it, yeah, most probably you won't chop it. You can limit the number of CPUs or number of threads that Hazelcast use, and in these cases you can prevent, or you can some, you know, give some CPU to your application and prevent the Hazelcast to use, or you can, and we have a back pressure feature, so you can enable it and give some limit of the incoming events, so your nodes won't be receiving events more than this, you know, number of back pressures, you know, events that you are configuring actually.
Just out of curiosity, how much has cloud impacted, cloud technologies impacted, you know, say distributed caching in general, beyond just Hazelcast?
Yeah.
So for instance, you know, features like containerization or auto-scaling and things like that, you know, it's a different paradigm from an,
yeah,
architectural perspective.
Yeah.
How does that impact you know, this class of support software, infrastructure software for designing applications, you know, distributed like sessions and things like that. Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, from we have four cases in Cascade, you know, case actually, it is not. Because for the most well known you know, deployment options that we have already some plugins, either Hazelcast engineers wrote them or some, you know, open source enthusiasts just wrote them. So if you wanna deploy into the Kubernetes, so there is that discovery plugin. So only thing you need to do instead of the IP based configurations that I have here, just leave it so you can see this. So instead of writing the number list here, all you need to do is actually so there is this discovery strategy. So only thing you need to do, just instead of, hey, I want to configure TCP/IP. No, I like configure multicast or discovery. Which discovery? It could be an AWS discovery. It could be a Kubernetes discovery. It could be a Azure discovery. It could be, you know, whatever discovery that you want to use. Then you know, this is just actually that part. Then also for some deployments. Things like, you know, the Heroku or like, you know, OpenShift or the Spring Cloud Foundry, we already have the packaged applications for the user. So all you need to do is just go to the marketplace and select the application and start the service. That's it. So you don't even need to bother all these configurations. If you want, there are some, you know, special properties there, you don't just need to configure them and that's it. Yep.
Is there documentation available about you know, tricky scenarios, for example, in Kubernetes, depending on the networking plugin, you might experience some slowdowns or with the category, you need to maybe specify special rules.
For what kind of rules?
Like networking and which member can connect or cannot connect.
But
it gets really
so by default, all Hazelcast members open connections to each other. So you can't prevent. Because the operations that Hazelcast member or clients are actually doing is member specific, meaning when
that's,
I have...
That's what I'm saying, but there's the Calico and really clamp down, let's say, Kubernetes deployment, the security rules might actually by default
block
prohibit
that. Okay, but then how am I going to create the cluster in the first place?
That's why I'm asking, do you have a documentation or automatic kind of a discovery that, oh, it looks like you're running this and therefore you need to specify such and such rules?
Let me think quickly. No, because the discovery is actually the first part or the entering part of the clustering. The discovery is only running while the member is trying to connect to the cluster. So if it can't connect to the cluster because of any of these issues, because I don't know, maybe this member is the one that is prohibited to connect it to the outside of the world, or maybe it is the other members in this side. So in this case, it will be running here on its own, most probably, because it's not connected to any of them. And the other two, three nodes will have a form a cluster here, and you know, run their own application there. So you will have, most probably in that scenario, if you can create some ports and etc., you may have two different clusters. One is consists of five, six members, whatever, and the other side there is just one sole lonely member. Since it couldn't find anyone else, it just started on its own, believing that it is the only member in the cluster and it's running. So to prevent this, what we can do, well, if you are blocking the TCP level, so there is nothing we can do, we are just opening a TCP socket between members. So we need to be able to open some sort of connections between two machines.
I understand that's what
two instances.
Asking if you have extensive documentation about deploying Hazelcast on a...
Yeah, we have.
Secured Kubernetes cluster.
For the in the Kubernetes API, in the Kubernetes discovery plugin itself, we have some documentation regarding how the members can find us what should be available or what should be opened in the Kubernetes side to be able to make the members be able to find each other. So it is documented there. But other than that, if it is not possible for that member to connect to the outside of Earth, it can't be part of the cluster.
That's, yeah.
That is what it is.
Just out of curiosity, you guys only use TCP, UDP, any other protocol?
Well, currently we are using just TCP, but
just curious.
For the future release, I believe for the 3.11 maybe, or 3.12, we are making some, analyzes to use some, UDP-based discovery or, hacking, connections, but it is just, in the lab. So our engineers are looking for options.
Any other questions? Cool.
No.
Well, thank you, Rukar.
Yep.
Thank you. All right. And.